One of us all sit up here. roll up.
I'll second that.
Yes.
Yes.
Griffin?
Yes.
Peterson?
Yes.
Peters?
Yes.
And Swedick?
Yes.
Six yes, excuse Councilwoman Waring.
All right, thank you. We're gonna change the schedule here a little bit, go directly to number two, come back to one when Steph gets here. Ordinance rules and claims, I'm gonna turn this over to Tim and have him give us some background on why this is on the agenda tonight, why he feels we need this.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is asking for an amendment to the minimum housing code. And how this came about is that last week, you recall, there was a cold snap. And our permits office and the chief building officer had received three complaints regarding the lack of heat at an apartment building. And being that our CBO was relatively new, he was asking about some emergency provision because the standard time frame under our minimum housing code is that the landlord is given no less than 30 days to bring about the remedy. And in situations where this might be dealing with aesthetics, how something looks, that might be reasonable, but when it's something that's viewed as a housing necessity, such as heat, when the outside temperature is in the 30s, or potable water, or running water, what have you, or electricity, if it's something that's in the purview of the landlord, then 30 days is the eternity. And so what this amendment does is it gives some discretion to the chief building officer, also known as the director of permits, that can look at each situation on a case-by-case basis and look at how many people are affected, what are the demographics are affected, and in that I mean, is this a frat house full of football players and wrestlers, or is this an assisted care facility? And of course, they'll have dramatic differences in what the ability to tolerate this lack of necessity. And one of the key provision in there is that I wanted to have something that the court, if we indeed we would have to take this to the municipal court, that they would be familiar with the definition of necessities. Because in North Canton, ours are a little tighter, if you will, that the amount of heat that's necessary for a situation. But by giving that definition to the revised code, what's in the Landlord-Tenant Act, the Canton Municipal Court is absolutely going to be familiar with that. They see those types of complaints every day. And what we're looking for is not necessarily the perfect fix for that, but to get it to a condition that certainly people aren't suffering, that the heat is reasonable for the conditions, that bottled water is available as close to it as immediately as possible, as well with running water. And all of this, again, on a case-by-case basis, where our CBO can go and figure out what's going on and give a reasonable time frame for the landlord to bring about the fix for the situation, whether it's parts or maintenance or cost, that they can look at how important this necessity is for this situation and then give a reasonable time frame. And if that doesn't occur, then we can take that to the Canton Municipal Court on an accelerated basis and bring about the relief for the tenants. So that's what you have here before you. Affordable Tenant Act and gives the authority to the housing officer, CBO, to make a determination on what's appropriate to resolve this lack of service of the necessities for the tenants.
Tim, is this a model after another ordinance?
It's not. It's something that I have crafted in simply looking at what we already had in our minimum housing code. I wanted to be a little clearer in the notice of violation, but that second paragraph is, as I went to the revised code to define the necessities, and the rationale for that, for one of our Canton Municipal Court judges to be very familiar with that aspect of what a necessity is. And if we cite it to our minimum housing code, I can imagine the court having to call through our codified ordinance and find out we define necessity, and they have a right to a jury trial if we have to get to that point where we bring in a prosecutor to have them bring this about. I wanted it to be in a type of language that they'd be certainly familiar with. So that's why I wanted to tap into the Landlord-Tenant Act for the definition of necessity. So we're gonna know exactly what we're talking about. It's not as though we're being overly sensitive in North Canton. Maybe our standard is perhaps too high, and I didn't want any confusion with what we're asking for. We're asking for the basic necessities that a landlord's required to provide to a tenant based on the Landlord-Tenant Act, and as well what will be in the lease that the tenant will have.
Like, that's where I was going with this. So the lease says, like in some cities, like let's say Canton City, the water has to stay in the landlord's name. In North Canton, we can get a duplicate copy.
Right.
The tenant can pay it. So where it says on the first paragraph, violation involves the owner, blah, blah, blah. It says heat and running water. So let's say North Canton, my tenant will pay their own heat and their own water.
Right.
But sometimes they don't pay the bill, so of course they get it shut off.
Correct.
So I want to make sure that there's a provision here that protects people that have properties where it's really the tenant's responsibility, which is rolled into the lease of it, right?
That's correct. And that's the rationale where the superintendent of the permits, the chief building officer, will examine the lease to make a determination of, oh, it appears that landlord provides the water or the heat, but if there's an underlying situation that, as you said, the water's been turned over to the tenant, and the reason that the water shut off is because the tenant hasn't paid their bill, and that's the reason why they're not receiving water, there's absolutely nothing that our person can do for it, except help them with that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Thanks. And that same rationale is anticipated under 53.2104 as well, where it talks about the landlord is obligated to provide certain rights to the tenant, and it would be, obligated to provide water. Now, the tenant's obligated to pay for it, so that's the difference there. But I think, I really love the rationale, Tim, of using those 51 references, because the municipal court judges see those every day, all the time. And so it's a set of standards that they're very familiar with. And it also is a very defined set of standards, so that we don't have people who would suggest that our CPO is going to be overreaching.
Right.
If we say, well, we think your house should be white instead of purple, you need to remedy that in 2 days. This would not allow us to do that. We would have to continue on the standard path. So I think it's a really good resource.
Thank you. And in addition, it's going to help the prosecutor too, because often when the cases get to the Canton Municipal Court, which is maybe once or twice a year, that something we have to bring up actually has to go that far, the very first thing they ask is, show me everything in your charter and your codified ordinances that I need to know to prosecute this. We're pointing right at the Landlord-Tenant Act, they know exactly what we're talking about. And Member Warren had just come in, and we had started on number two.
Okay.
And so, yeah, that's what we're discussing. She and I had gone over this last week, and I made the recommendation to her, this is certainly her committee, that this is a bit of a, I don't want to call it a loophole there, but it's something that we have in the housing code for the purpose of, initially it appears that it's for aesthetics and having people maintain the property in a certain way, but there's no doubt that there are certain provisions in there that we hold landlords accountable. And it would be unfair to have that same kind of 30 days to paint your house or to make some kind of a aesthetic repair to a premises and keep that in the same relation when, say, there's a leak in the roof and it comes right through the living room. That's a repair that just simply can't wait 30 days.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
So really there's only two, I was reading subsection six, it's really only water and heat are the only two things.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we're very limited in seeing
anything. Yeah, sounds good.
I have a question.
Yes.
So you're saying that
we've had some complaints coming up on other ones, we're going to put this under emergency.
And one of the things that we were talking about this, and John Steigel, the CBO and Director of Permits, had asked me, what can we do with the emergency situations? And I had suggested that this was late in the day, like about 3:30 last week, and I said, well, I recommend that you contact the landlord, let the landlord know that we're taking a very close look at this, and this is the process that we think we need to put in place to turn this around and to investigate it and get and determine exactly what the scenario is and make sure they understand how we're reviewing this and what our intent is, and that upon some subsequent research, the only emergency provision that we have in there is when we would need to vacate the premises because of the fear of imminent harm. And certainly when the issue is lack of heat, an emergency provision that says we're going to put you out on the street is not what they're looking for. So while we were putting this together nearly the very next day, Mr. Steigel contacted me and said the heat's back on. They went ahead and fixed it, but we still wanted to go forward with this because we could have one of these complaints tomorrow and we're still faced with the same circumstances of an extensive time frame to effect a repair for something that someone really shouldn't go more than a day without one of these necessities.
Just has to be reasonable. Like I had a water well go out, and I got it done in 2 days, which was a miracle to get it done that quick. The well went out, and my tenants were all out of water. So, you know, you do it as quick as you can possible.
Right.
Well, do you think it's enough sturdy?
Any other questions?
No.
Thanks for the next question. Yes, sir. All right, we'll go back to number one. The agenda, community development, Chairwoman Keesman.
Has anybody get out to the property? Have any questions? Talk about setbacks, did you see how far 200 feet really was? Okay. So at this point, if anybody has any suggestions, comments, I mean, we've gone through it pretty much line by line, but we've also, as of today, hired a consultant to help us look at it in a very, hopefully, very quick fashion. Pat, you want to explain? I asked Pat to find this one, and he was a wizard and did it quickly.
Well, we'll see if I'm still the wizard at this all.
Okay.
I think that the direction of the mayor and the chief building officer in conjunction with Marcia really the, you know, the impetus behind making this happen. I conducted an expedited search looking for certain parameters that I felt would lead us to a conclusion of, you know, we're trying to help, we want this to be successful. But we want to make sure that the city's interests are, you know, represented. And I didn't like the choices that we've had in the past, so I felt we needed new eyes on this. So I developed a target list of who I wanted to go with, and started with the first one and felt that it happened, met my requirements, that we would give that one a shot. Walked it around, and we received some feedback from others, and here's the result. So I asked that, well, first of all, the name of the firm is Calfee Zoning, C-A-L-F-E-E. The principal to that is an individual by the name of Sean Suter. Just a little quick background on him. He was the chief counsel for land use and planning for the city of Cincinnati from 2010 to 2014. He served as lead counsel for the city's new zoning and land development code and award-winning historic preservation ordinance. He represented the city in all land use, zoning, and historic preservation matters, including advising and representing the Department of the City Planning, City Planning Commission, Board of Appeals, Zoning Board of Appeals, etc. He found that after serving in public service that there were a lot of other opportunities outside of public service, so he formed his own business in 2014, merged with a law practice throughout Ohio that specializes just in zoning issues. He's a licensed attorney in Ohio, Kentucky, and Tennessee, and he received his bachelor's degree in urban and environmental planning from the University of Virginia School of Architecture, and he earned his Juris Doctorate from the University of Virginia Law School. He travels around mostly the eastern part of the United States, giving lectures and whatnot on zoning. He was in Cleveland last Friday. He was the guest speaker for the American Planning Association. So what I asked him to do is to break this effort into three parts and price each part so we can see how it was. The first part will be to perform a review and analysis of what the North Star plan had submitted to our planning commission, which was the basis of what is being shown in the Field Crest Historic District. Those documents have been provided to him. The cost for this, and what I laid out to him in my notes was that, you know, what we're looking for is to find, you know, what's right in there. It's right. We're not looking to find something wrong where there's nothing wrong. We are okay with things that are right in there. We just don't know, from our point of view, that the city's interests were represented. So that's all. Could very well be they weren't, and that's okay. To the extent that there's something in there that would be a cause for concern based on their experience representing other municipalities in Ohio or around the area, we would like you to identify what those areas are. That's part of it. The cost for that is $2,975. Part two is then, if we like what we've seen in part one, where it was demonstrated that they handled the scope of the project, addressed it well. We feel confident in what we're reading about when we go to part two, which then would be to put in writing what your remedies are for the things that you feel need addressed from part one. So if you feel that this little section could be written a little better, or that it's problematic, here's what I would do or recommend that you do to make that happen. That would be part two.
How much is part two?
Part two is $5,525.
Okay.
Part three would be to present your report and findings to the city council in a public forum, to be able to answer all questions posed from city council, from law director, members of the administration, to the extent that we have it in a town hall setting, the answer to the public. I just laid out every scenario for him. And the cost to do all of that is on that part three is $4,500. So the grand total is $13,000. We can do part one, not part two. We can do part one and two and three. You know, wherever we feel we want to stop trading, we can certainly do that. So I thought that that was good in setting it up in that way. The concern with timetable, so specific time going over that with member Keeson and Warren's input. And we feel that we can complete part one and two within 30 days. So that is contingent upon starting immediately. I think if we deal with holidays coming up, and we're going to kind of try to through that kind of thing. So the part three about making the presentation before council, we were a little concerned with the holiday schedule. And so that's why we didn't set that up, that that has to be done within 30 days, that part that this could put us into, right around Christmas, or, I'm not sure what the schedule is here, but we were going to the last day. But anyway, I think we've got a lot of flexibility. We executed that contract this morning, and after the law director reviewed it as a form of contract, the finance director certified that we had funds available to pay, and we were ready to begin tomorrow morning.
Sounds like
that. That's awesome. Thank you so much.
Yeah. I think when we talked about this last week, I think what really intrigued us was we're not saying there's anything wrong with the way it was presented. Northstar made that a great job. We did ask them to hire someone, which they did, and he gives a great explanation about what it is. But it's just a double check. They might even give a great suggestion for that they didn't think about. But I loved how it was in three parts, and it could come back, and maybe it was just a few tweaks, and we only need to go to part two. We don't even need part three. Maybe it stays at part one. But it's just that checks and balance, and it might be another opportunity for Bill Crest to even see something. It doesn't really draw on the process at all. It keeps us really with where we are. I was also at their GLOW event, so I've been out a couple times to look at the setbacks. I was at their GLOW event, and it was amazing. You know, and again, it just said to me what an asset it is, and the amount of people, and you're from all over the community, and probably even outside of Stark County, and just such a treasure again, and what they're trying to do. So I think great idea.
And I would be remiss in mentioning as well that we asked that this be structured as a maximum all-in price, that I'm not interested in an hourly billable hours. I'm not interested in your travel expenses or things like that. You're not engaging in that meeting for that. It's just a slack fee, whatever, however much time it takes.
Yeah, the nice thing too is since we've last met, again, talking to a lot of neighbors, we're not hearing a lot of negative. I heard one comment about traffic. Literally, they live across the street, and they know that, and Field Press is, they want two metrics, so they're working with engineering on that too, and that's another proposal, and, but everything else is really positive.
Thanks, Jayden. Thanks.
So we're going to move forward with that. We're still going to have a public hearing next week. Get that part of it over and then start moving forward as we get information. So, probably back to the agenda.
Okay, next up, we have re-upping the memorandum of understanding between Stark County Sheriff's Office and North Canton Police Department. Mike, are there any changes to this memorandum of understanding?
There is none, sir. It's just a new year, a new agreement with them. There's no cost to us.
And this is the for the OVI task force, for the folks that are here tonight that aren't aware of this. We do this every year. We enter into an agreement with Stark County Sheriff, what used to be with the University of Akron. And the last couple of times, it's been with the Stark County Sheriff's, and this is at no cost.
Correct.
Reimbursement. They reimburse, and they've had some great success. Are there any questions regarding this?
No.
Okay, Ms. Dowd?
They do this every year.
Every year.
Yeah.
Mike, I noticed that this is, we get into this agreement, it'll be backdated to October 1st, is that correct, or is it November 1st? I'm looking at here, it says effective October 1st, terminated on September 30th of 18.
It'll go into effect whenever we sign it, whenever legislation is passed. So we just may not participate in that, so they hold us on here.
So have we participated in the last month?
I don't believe we've done anything in the last month.
So we'll be reimbursable?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. That will be on emergency as well. All right, moving on, finance and property, Chairman Griffin.
I'm going to excuse myself for the initial item.
Yes, thank you.
No for me.
Okay.
Member Griffin, next in the room.
Yes. I'm going to turn this over to you.
Sure. Every couple of years, the city has to look for new quotes and bids on the property and liability insurance. And that's what this is doing. And we've used the same consulting group from Huntington on this as we did with our health insurance. So they go through all the application and help us find the best quotes in the marketplace. Then we're working with the administrator to do that.
Good. Yes, I'm okay. So, okay, please tell me that for next week, I guess. Yeah.
No questions?
Okay.
Next week.
All right.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
Significantly less expensive than what we anticipate the generator for this building, so I think that's a good sign.
Part of the cost that's built in here is they have a lumber generator currently from the company that's replacing it, so they're not out.
Yes. Other questions about that? We'll put it on the agenda for next week.
Sounds good. Now, this is our last meeting before Friday, Veterans Day is on Friday. I'll take a moment and thank all the veterans and their families for their service, their sacrifice, and selflessness. And we have something planned for Friday. Mayor, would you like to?
Yeah, there's going to be a Veterans Day ceremony with the Chamber of Commerce, and that'll be out at Pittsburgh Park, and that will start at
11
o'clock. So everybody is welcome there. We've done this before.
Do we have, well, is there a person that's singing the national anthem, or?
Middle school, yeah, that's part of, this program, and also high school students that normally would be there in DC at this time, but they had some letters that were written, I believe Dr. Rogan is going to be there to read these letters, starting to give it to the students, they have some emotional connections.
So we have the best of that, I'm sorry.
We have the details on our webpage, so. Is there a webpage for the details?
And there's plenty of commission this Wednesday.
Tomorrow's voting day, get out vote.
Yeah.
That's right. All right, that concludes the agenda. Entertain motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hello.